That was a great bong toke.
Yeah, indeed.
And we're back, and the machine's done its thing. It's stopped now.
The machine's done its thing, and I would normally suggest that you have the next part that we're going to do already done, because we don't want to leave the resin in the water any longer than it needs to be left. There are water-soluble terpenes and terpenoids that give us the flavors and tastes, and we want to keep them in the plant matter, or I should say in the resin, rather than have them leach out into the water. So what I'm going to do is we're going to put the new bags, and I say the new bags because today we're going to run the bubble bag lights kits.
Bubble bag lights. What's the difference between the regular bubble bags and these?
Well, right off the bat, the big difference is that the old schoolers will notice that, now this is an 8-bag kit.
Yeah.
I used to have them, the original bubble bags are still the original colors, but one way I was able to cut corners and save people some money was making less colors in the bags.
Right.
So each bag still have its individual screen, and if you look at each bag at first, you might not notice it, but like for instance, this red bag, which is the 220, mm-hmm. has a blue piping around the screen. That's the original color of the original bag.
Right.
The next bag in the order is the white bag. There's four white bags, and this one's the 190, and it's got a green piping, as well as thread, mm-hmm. that signifies the 190 original screen. And then right. it goes so on. This is the 160, the red, the orange is the 120, and it goes right into the blue is the 73 bag.
Okay.
That's the yellow, our yellow bag. And then our final, we've got white, and then finally purple. So it's just a way for us to kind of cut a corner and save some money for the people.
More cost effective then.
You know what, really? We're going to retail these for $150, and we retail bubble bag originals for $320, and that's for a 5-gallon, 8-bag kit. So
you're passing the savings on to the consumer then?
Yeah, that's the whole purpose of doing it, absolutely, was to get people that are, you know, there's a lot of people that are doing all sorts of different things with chemical extractions, and kids that don't know what they're doing, and they're getting into trouble and having explosions, and I just thought, here's a nice alternative to some kids that maybe aren't. They don't have a chemistry lab at their disposal, and they potentially don't have a chemistry degree. So here's some bags, you know, here's some dry sieve screen. Let's give them some alternatives. Mm-hmm. You know, some of these kids are like 20, 22, 23 years old. That's just too young to be having any type of explosion thing that has anything to do with cannabis. So
this is 100% safe extraction method here, folks.
Yeah, you know, especially
burn down your house with this.
Yeah, you gotta leave those other extractions to the professionals. Now, this is something that anyone can learn how to do. It's pretty simple. So what I'm going to do right now is line the bags in order.
Right.
The first bag is the 25 micron. How I knew that was it had the purple piping on it. But also each bag will say on the label.
Oh, there it is.
The micron size of the screen.
Right on.
So 45 goes into the 25. You want them stacked like this, of course, because making a mistake. Here, I can even put these up here. Making a mistake with these particular, the screen order would be detrimental. The resin wouldn't flow through if you had a smaller bag on top of a larger bag, right?
Gotcha, yeah.
So I generally just push these in. It's, you don't have to overthink it. Oh, how far do they need to be apart? Just jam them all in. It's like, these things are so small that even with these screens apparently touching under a microscope, they would be miles apart from one another and plenty of room for resin to fall.
Right.
And sink through.
So we're relying on gravity to a degree here, right?
Gravity is a huge function right here, but it's not just gravity. It's the fact that resin is the resin head, the glandular trichome head, is oil and its density. Mm-hmm. So because of its density, it's still affected by gravity, whereas everything else in the bucket is pretty much not affected by gravity. It's floating.
Right.
So. Yeah, it's definitely...
So what's floating is mostly the unwanted plant material, right?
Yeah, like all the plant matter, which we would think of as leaf and greenery, and then, of course, all the a lot of the cistiliteres and the capitate stalks. And I'll pass some pictures to Remo so he can insert a couple of photos into this video to show you what I'm talking about. And these are parts of the trichome, and they're sort of... when you get under the macroscope or the microscope, you can see these things, and you're like, oh, that looks good, that looks interesting. They're non-active. It's only the head of the trichome that's active. So
right.
you get piles of dry sift on a single screen, and literally people think it looks great to the naked eye. You get the microscope under there, and it's 80% contaminant.
Right.
So today what we're going to do with the bags is literally create a 99% gland head purity. Cool. We'll isolate the heads. That's what we're going to be able to do.
Sounds good to me.
Yeah, me too. So this is our yellow bag. You can see by the piping. And then we're going to go with the... This is the 73, and this is the 90 that goes above it. So yeah, you always want your bigger bag going into the to the next bags. All right. Done this on many occasions all around the world. Jamaica being one of my favorites.
Mine too.
Yeah, yeah, we did that, didn't we? That was real fun.
The weather's so nice there too.
We made a little bit of bubble there, didn't we?
We did, and we smoked it with a doctor. He called it living gold, folks. Remember that?
The living gold, I'll never forget it.
The doctor.
That was so good. That guy was such a great guy, such a good, legitimate fellow, you know, like real gardener.
Yeah.
Hard worker, like you remember climbing up to his place?
Oh yeah, I remember his long dreadlocks that
7 foot.
He held them out like this and he's, you know, almost hit the ground.
They went past the ground. I have photos of him standing up at kind of up on a little ledge about this tall, and they go way past his feet onto the ground.
Insane.
Yeah, he hadn't cut his hair in like 25 years. So that last bag was the 120. We put that on top of the 90, and now we're about to put the 160 down. I usually consider the 160 a contaminant bag, but sometimes it produces some nice glands, depending on how big the gland heads are in that particular strain. All right, 190, and then we're still gonna use our 220, even though there's a 220 bag in here. We're still going to use it just in case.
Like double filtering.
Yeah, basically. You never know that something might have gotten through the zipper, or there might have been some type of an accident with the zipper. Sometimes it happens. Just in case, I like to have my 220 bag. All the kits come with them, so you know, 99% of people that have these bags are going to have this one. You might as well.
Might as well use it.
You might as well use it. And you can see the quality is there for a lighter, cheaper version of bubble bags. We certainly didn't go too light on the quality. We tried to really keep it there and still do the same great job.
And we're almost ready to roll, eh?
Yeah, right away we're gonna do this. Here, I guess.
I got an idea.
Is that
perfect? This is perfect, yeah.
What if I flip this up?
Perfect!
Like this.
Great idea.
We'll put that up
like that, and then we'll literally.
Oh, whoops, there it goes.
A little mess, but not too bad. It's a gravity feed, so it's just wanting to jump out there.
Because it's water in it. Because it's sure got a color to it, eh?
Yeah, it's, if you look at the angle, it's almost a goldish color with a tinge of green because it was fresh frozen. We didn't certainly overmix. We kept it nice and cold. Sometimes a little bit of chlorophyll will leach out, but it seems to dry out properly. I'll give that a little wipe.
Gonna take care of this.
Yeah.
So you don't have a sticky floor.
I think it's a good idea. Yeah.
Oh, thanks.
Excellent. So I usually just run a little bit of extra.
Just to rinse any of that?
Yeah, I mean, not to, you know, it's not a huge rinse, but it's just to kind of...
I don't know, it's coming out pretty gold.
Oh, yeah. There we go, more of a clear color at the end.
I think you got it all. Pretty close.
It's a pretty efficient little machine, I gotta say. Every little bit counts. Silly. That's perfect. We're not going to be doing this on camera today, but what I would suggest to you know, people back home is that you would just take clean water, fill this back up. This still has plenty of ice. You can hear that sound. That's the sound you want to have lots of ice left, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you could just run it again. You could literally just put your water in there, run the machine for another 3 to 5 minutes or 10 or 15 for those that just can't wrap it around their heads that they, you know, oh no, there must be more in there. We have to mix it for a long time. You're welcome to do that, but just do it on your second run, not on your first run. And I have some people that run it 2-3 times.
Really?
I like to just run it once myself. So I guess what we'll do now is we're just going to take a quick break while we set up the drying area, and we'll be back in 2 minutes.
Another bong toke.
Yeah, let's have a bong toke as well.
Back in a bong toke, folks.
Okay, perfect. Excellent.